What is going on, everybody? Welcome to another Python tutorial video series. This series is going to be talking about PyQt with Python. So PyQt is a wrapper around the Qt framework, which is a framework for creating GUIs. We're going to be using the QT4 framework. There are two frameworks. There's QT4 and QT5. QT5 is a slightly newer, but it comes with a lot more dependencies, and it also has a slightly different licensing kind of process than QT4 does. QT4 is much simpler, much more black and white and vanilla to use, so therefore I think it would be best to go ahead and use QT4. So Qt, how does it differ from, say, tkinter or WXPython? Because all of these are GUI development frameworks, so why should we use PyQt or learn another framework? A lot of it's going to come down to user preference, or at least developer preference, and Qt is a little more updated, I would say. Back when, maybe a few years ago, I wouldn't have really said such a thing, but maybe even WXPython would have come first because they were constantly putting updates out. But now, I would say Qt is by far the most up-to-date framework for creating Windows, and it's going to look the best on a lot of systems. So this is going to be the most cross-platform compatible GUI that you're going to find, pretty much. And you can easily change the style. So like with tkinter, you can really only change to like one style until you need to you have to code the style completely, and that takes a lot of code. So with Qt, it comes with a bunch of styles, but it also comes with a lot of really intuitive widgets that just make sense to have pre-built in. So obviously there's a lot of stuff with Qt or any framework that they can't envision that you want to do, but Qt comes pretty well packed with a lot of widgets, and a lot of widgets that are going to be cross-platform and make sense per operating system that you use it on. So anyways, now that I've sort of sold you on QT4, the best thing to do is really just try them out. Try out all the frameworks, see what suits you best, because they're all a little different, and most importantly, to develop with them is a little different. And honestly, QT4 so far, for like, if you're gonna make a big application, my experience with Qt so far has been really good. Actually, I like them more than I really liked tkinter initially, but tkinter makes it pretty hard to make a large application, whereas Qt, honestly, Qt makes it pretty darn simple. So let's go ahead and just jump in. So the first thing that you're going to have to do is actually acquire Qt. So to do that, you're going to come to Riverbank Computing, the parent company, and you're going to want to go to this link, basically software, PyQt, and download. Now, if you're on Windows, that's what you want to do pretty much. You come down here and download the installer that suits you. Okay, so this would be Qt 4.8.6 for Windows 64, and then this would be for Windows 32. Now, if you're not on Windows, if you're on Mac or Linux, you should be able to get by with a simple sudo apt-get install python -qt4. That is all you should have to run, and that should install QT4 for you. Once you have those things, drink your coffee, and you're ready to move on. So you're going to pretty much always have the a couple things. You're going to pretty much always import sys, and you're almost always, actually, there's some scenarios where you might not import the GUI aspect, but anyway, from PyQt4 import QtGui. Now, this, note the caps here, they're kind of confusing, especially GUI. I want to capitalize everything in GUI, but no, it's just the capital G. They followed PEP 8 past the whole caps thing. Anyways, PyQt4 import QtGui. So this is like the, basically QtGui is all the major GUI aspects. There's also QtCore, which we'll use kind of not too long in the future. And then those are the two major ones that you're pretty much always going to use. But there are other ones. So Qt comes with things like QtOpenGL for including OpenGL, which is really cool. Of course, you can always include OpenGL in your WXPython, your tkinter. So all you fanboys don't need to jump out at me, but it's a little easier in Qt. So you can do that. There's QtXML, QtSvg, so XML for XML, obviously. SVG, support vector graphics, QtSql, QtNetworking, and the list goes on. So there's a lot of kind of like built-in handling for these sorts of things. Now, of course, again, like with QtSql, do you have to use QtSql for your SQL handling? No, but it's going to be a little more useful. So anyways, moving on, you're going to basically always have these two imports for sure. If you're making GUIs, surely you're going to use the GUI. So anyway, but I can envision some people might just happen to really like, I don't know, QtNetwork. You like the handling of it, so maybe you'll use QtNetwork with something else. I don't know. So anyway, you're going to have those two imports. Now, in your application, your GUI, whatever, you're always going to have the same kind of three major aspects. First, you're going to have some sort of app definition. So the whole application. So app equals QtGUI.QApplication. And then here we're going to pass sys.argv. Now, if you're not familiar with sys.argv, you can come to pythonprogramming.net, start learning, go to search, type in sys, and here's what you want. And basically what it's going to let you do is argv is going to allow you when you could call this application from the command line, and you could pass arguments via the command line. Now, you don't have to put sys.argv here, but you have to put something. You can't go home, but you can't stay here. Anyway, you can put in here empty list or something like that, and then you don't have to put anything there. You'll see some people do that, but sys.argv makes the most sense to put there anyway. But some people are just like really adamant about not putting sys.argv, so we'll do this instead. So anyway, you do that. Next, you're going to have something that defines the GUI, the window, whatever it is. So we're going to go ahead and say, for now, let's say window equals QtGUI.QWidget. Now, one thing that I do like that PyQt has done for us is generally when you're referencing any sort of Qt class, they're going to go ahead and throw a capital Q in front of it. So you can look at your code really quick and know, wait, is that my method or is that Qt's method? You can look at it and you'll just know because of the Q pretty fast. And they do that for a lot of things. So I really do appreciate that from PyQt. So anyways, that's just a quick widget. And then finally, you're going to always have window.show. So you're always going to have a .show to your application. Otherwise, what happens is that everything is created in memory. And then as soon as you call it to show, then it shows. Because that's how graphics work. Graphics are all created kind of in the background. And then when you finally want them to show, you show. Because graphics take the most memory. And it just makes sense to build it first in the background and then bring it up. So that's your application, and that's basically, you're always going to use this sort of structure. Now, of course, there's going to be a lot more involved as we go down the road, but for now, this is a basic window. So let's go ahead and save and run that with F5. Anyway, from PyQt for import QT GUI, drink more coffee, and here you have your basic window. Now, we've just done this in three lines, but really more than three lines went into this. So this window can be resized. It looks like a window. It looks the same as, you know, you can bring this window over. It kind of follows that same kind of see-through look. It's got the same buttons here. For anyone who's curious, this is for team viewers, so you probably don't have that button, so don't feel like you're falling behind because you don't have that button. But this window resizes. It's even got this little shadow. It maximizes it. Maximizes, I'm not sure what you'd call that, and most importantly, it can exit out. So we already have all these little handling features that we didn't have to code at all for ourselves. Now, the other thing I'm going to show really quick before we move on to the next video is the title to your window, and then also the size and starting point. So once you've defined your window, you've got this nice window object. What we can do is we can go window.setGeometry, and you can say the set geometry takes four parameters. It's the starting point, so starting X, starting Y, and then the dimensions, so the X and Y, or the width and the height. Now, like most GUI applications, the starting points are really up here. So 0, 0 is always like top left. Most GUI applications are like that. Like Kiwi is an example of one that's from the bottom left, so that's really annoying for me because I'm used to like everything top left. But if you work with like HTML or anything else, or all the other GUI frameworks, it's top left. Anyway, so set geometry, we're going to have a starting point 50, 50, and then we'll say the window is 500 pixels wide and 300 pixels tall. The other thing we can do really simply is window.set window title, and then you can pass in whatever window title you want. We'll call this PyQt tuts. So let's go ahead and save and run that one. And that comes up, and here you have a nice window. It followed our rules about being 500 wide, 300 tall, and it did start at 50-50. Now, one thing I will just mention is you can start a window at 0-0. A 0-0 is going to show us a little bit more of a fundamental thing about this window. So, as you can see, my window is off the screen. I film in 1080p. It's my full monitor, at least for this monitor. But I have a monitor that sits over here and a monitor that sits up here, so above this window. So there's one to the left, actually there's one to the right too, and one above. So this window didn't really appear on this screen. It's on three total screens. So if you just had one monitor, chances are it probably appeared like this. But it tried to go up here, but your operating system was like, that's silly. So it stuffed it down here for you because it has a nice little handling for stupid choices. So what happened there? Well, 0-0, what is that in reference to? Well, like I was saying, you've got an application and then you've got a window. And you might also hear this generally referred to as you've got a frame and then you've got a window. So the frame is what's around the window. And then you've got the actual window, which starts here. And that's why when we said started at 0-0, this point was at 0-0, not like this fake corner that should be here without the rounded edges. So keep that in mind. It wouldn't matter. You could do 0-0 all day if you want, but it will show up off screen for some users. So that's kind of annoying sometimes. Anyway, that's that with this simple application. Normally, it's going to be, you're going to be using object-oriented programming, you've got classes and all this, and we really did use object-oriented programming, you just didn't see it yourself, but there's a lot of, basically everything here is an object, and we're modifying the object here. So anyway, that's what we're going to get into in the next video, is kind of converting this to the sort of structure that you're going to tend to use when creating an application. So that's what you guys have to look forward to. If you have any questions or comments up to this point, please feel free to leave them below. Otherwise, as always, thanks for watching, thanks for all the support and subscriptions, and until next time.